Welcome to the Real Chili Podcast.
And the Golden Eagles of Marquette University in Milwaukee are bound for the Final Four for only the third time ever.
5 seconds left. Marquette down by one, trying to avoid the upset. Blew the drive, the left hand. It's good!
Every day, as basketball players, as students, and I want to win every day, most importantly, as people.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Real Chili Podcast. I'm your host, Mike Lavender. I'm joined by Brian Henry, Pete Worth, and Pete Mohan. And Marquette just capped off a three-game win streak, topped off with a 90-44 victory over the Western Carolina University Catamounts in Milwaukee. Up next, we have our first true road game against the Georgia Bulldogs, and we're going to preview that in the second half of this show. But first, we wanted to kind of talk about some of the big picture things and some of the things we saw over the past several games, three of the easiest games of the season on Marquette's schedule. The most dominant came tonight against Western Carolina. And Pete Worth, wow, Western Carolina is a bad basketball team.
Yeah, they're really bad. They're one of the worst basketball teams I think I've ever seen play a college basketball game. We did shoot the ball lights out, which was great to see in the first half. But that game was kind of like watching a really drunk person at the bar. Like, at first it was really fun and humorous, but then it just got disgusting. But it was great to see us shoot the ball that well in the first half, that's for sure.
Thrilling to see us shoot the ball that well. It was three awful opponents. I think we're all well aware of that. Scoring over 100 points twice is great. Tonight, I think they got to 90. Rousey leading the way. They hit a bunch of threes. Marcus Howard was terrific. My thought through these three games, I think the biggest takeaway is that I think we're seeing Marcus Howard begin to, not to put a firm grasp, but at least start to wrap his arms around the starting point guard role and our primary ball handler. And I think Wojo, in giving him more minutes, is announcing we need that position to score the ball, and that's why Marcus is out there. Pete Mohan, did you feel the same way?
Wojo's shown that he's going to ride the hot hand. Howard getting 10 three-point attempts in a game is an obscene amount of three-point shots. But still, make 4 out of 10, that's 40%.
You know what else is obscene? Western Carolina's three-point defense.
Well, it's going to be hard to guard all of Marquette's shooters throughout the season, no matter who the opponent is. 13 out of 27 on the night, 48%. You can't ask for anything more than that. And most nights in the Big East, if you shoot like that, you will win games. So I'm glad that guys are getting in a rhythm now. We're getting minutes for just about everyone, all the way down to the walk-on guys. Not that we're going to need them, but it's good that everyone's getting in a rhythm from the three-point line.
Can I pose a question to the group? Mike, you and I have gone back and forth on this. I think we'd all agree that this is a better three-point shooting team. The numbers do bear that out. I think coming into tonight, we were around 36-point-something. Obviously, hitting the shots tonight, they'll probably jump to 37, 38. That's terrific. Don't we all agree, though, those numbers are probably coming down in conference play? Is that fair? And is this team good enough to win at a 34% clip? I'm just curious, because it's not – they're better, but they're not that much better.
Before the game, I ran the numbers for assist-to-turnover ratio for Big East players. Hanif Cheatham leads the Big East by a significant margin, actually, at 2.6 per game. And four of the top 15 guys – in the Big East are Marquette players. Cheatham, Dwayne is number 3, Jawan is number 10, and Tracy is number 15. So seeing our progression from last year, I think for me it has a lot to do with ability to handle the ball without turning it over and making the right plays out there. And that smart guard play is something that you want to have in a Big East schedule.
To your point about the three-point shooting, and you're right, we have gone back and forth about it. I think, you know, you look at our two losses that we have so far, Michigan and Pittsburgh, and collectively as a team, we shot 26% and 28% respectively in both of those games from the three-point line. The first two games of the season against Vanderbilt and Howard, we were around 40, 41, 42%. So we shoot the ball better. We have the real ability to shoot the ball better, but we haven't proven we can do that against teams with length. Teams with consistent length that can throw a lot of depth
out there, and that's exactly what we're going to
bother your shots.
And that's in passing lanes, obviously. And that's what we're going to see in Georgia. That's what we're going to see in Wisconsin. So
yeah, the better the athlete, the better they're able to cut off passing lanes and also driving lanes, which has been hugely important because these three games against these three cupcakes that we've played, we've moved the ball so well. There was a possession today against Western Carolina early in the first half where I think Luke kicked it back out to I think it was Marcus Howard for a three where the ball zipped around to all five guys and got it into the post and kicked it back out for the open shot. I haven't seen a Marquette team move the ball like this that well, even against these kind of inferior, terrible opponents, frankly. But so that's a good sign to see, and that's going to be much more difficult against, you know, the Georgias, Fresno States, Wisconsins of the world. But we have to rely on Howard and Juwan Johnson, Dwayne Wilson, Tracy Carter, all these guys to be able to get into the lane, penetrate, and then kick out.
Yeah, exactly. And I think now we've probably gone to the depths of the things that we think we can realistically glean from these past few games. So let's transition to a little bit more of a Georgia preview. Marquette is going to travel down to Athens, Georgia for a game on December 4th. This is a big game for Marquette. This is a Georgia team that is in the same ballpark as Marquette, at least in terms of talent, around the same level as Pittsburgh. It's clearly going to be on the road. This is a big test for us, and it's also a challenge because Georgia has a lot of length. Yonte Maton is kind of their flagship player. He comes in at, I think, 6. He's a beast. He comes in at 6'8 or 6'9. We're going to be put in a position defensively against Georgia where Hauser and Fisher are going to have to be out there together, and Hauser's going to have to do a hell of a job on defense at the four. He's done a good job so far, but I don't think he's quite been matched up with the skill and the size that Georgia's going to throw at us, maybe against Michigan, but we were out of that game so quickly it wasn't a contest. Brian Henry, I know you did some scouting and even watched some game tape. Impressive, by the way, on Georgia. What did you see from them that you think we can expect? Maybe from a defensive perspective first.
Georgia, I'll say this. They're long. They're not as ridiculously big as you would think an SEC school would be. Nobody taller than 6'8 on the roster, although they do have four guys that are 6'8. Defensively, I sat and watched them play Kansas. Now, again, that's against one of the top five teams in America. They bounce back and forth between a 2-3 zone and man-to-man. How much of that was the fact that they're trying to slow down Kansas? You know, would they throw that against us? I would doubt it. I think they'll try and match up one and match up man-to-man with our guys for the majority of the game. There are opportunities against them. Going in after watching what I watched on the road, I think this is a very winnable game, and I think Marquette should win it. I'd be thoroughly disappointed if they didn't win it because what it likely means if they don't is that Maton is able to get off and do whatever he wants, which he still could do in a Marquette victory if you take away the other options effectively. But I still think this is a must-see watch if you're a Marquette fan, guys, as to who's going to guard Yonte Maton. How is Wojo going to guard him? How are the defensive rotations? Because I think we'd all agree in those Michigan and Pittsburgh games, they were poor. Below average, not good, and we got absolutely torched on a lot of pick and roll to the basket. They want to get Yonte Maton the ball in every situation. They'll get it to him at the top of the key. They'll get it to him on the wings. They will post him. It will be absolutely fascinating to see how they're going to game plan and try to defend him because it'll be the best player, best individual scorer next to Young of Pittsburgh because he's just as good. But this will be the best individual player, I think, overall skill set wise that Marquette has played this season.
It's possible it might be the best player we face all season. I mean, this guy
potentially
is, not only is he good, but he's efficient. He doesn't really turn the ball over. He shoots, his true shooting percentage is 61%. I mean, he shoots it well from everywhere on the court. And think back to last year when Ben Bentel beat us up a couple times, even though we won both Providence games, but that type of forward gives us a lot of trouble defensively.
And what impressed me the most about him in a game, Georgia wasn't good enough to beat Kansas, he still went for 30 points and 13 rebounds and kept them afloat. And he's good enough to completely take over if he gets the buzz to do that. Now, here's what I think will play in our advantage. It's a Sunday afternoon game, an NFL Sunday.
at a football school where they're not, I don't think they're dialed into basketball season yet. I look, Georgia's average.
They're worried about that Falcons game.
They're all watching the Falcons.
Yeah, Georgia's averaging around 6,000 to 8,000 at a home game. I don't think it's going to be a super tough environment to play in. I think it's a great opportunity for Marquette to go in there and win. I don't think they're going to blow them up, but I think you can win decisively. I don't think it's going to be a tough place to play. I think there's one key, stop Maiton. The rest of that lineup, J.J. Frazier, their senior guard, pretty solid. He's around 13 points and 4 assists a game, but he's small. He's 5'10", 155 pounds. Howard's going to have a chance to do a nice job defensively against him.
They're basically a two-man band. Like, Maiton and J.J. Frazier are their main guys, and they're really their only reliable scorers. And if we can let Maiton kind of get his, Georgia is a terrible, terrible three-point shooting team.
Terrible.
Terrible. Yeah.
313th in the country, according to KenPom.
But 11 for 32 for J.J. Frazier.
Frazier can hit his. And Maiton's actually hit a couple. He hasn't taken that many, but he can. Mm-hmm. He does have the capability of hitting some. The rest of the guys, not so much. Not good two-point shooters either. So I'd be curious to see if we even play some zone. I don't know. I don't know if Wojo thinks he can trust Fisher and Hauser, basically our other forwards, to kind of pack the baseline and be able to box out guys, find guys to box out in a zone. I'd be curious to see if he tries it, knowing that the rest of Georgia's perimeter players aren't that great of shooters. Brian, what do you think after watching the Kansas game? Because I know Kansas switched to the zone.
Pete, I would not be surprised if Marquette did play some zone. When Kansas did switch to that zone, the rest of the team shot 8 for 37 from the floor. While Maiton in that game got his 30 points and 13 boards. So if you're scouting and watching that film, which I'm sure obviously the Marquette coaching staff is, I'm sure zone will look appealing. I'm sure a lot of teams will do it to Georgia the rest of the way just because of how poorly they handled it against Kansas. Now, take for granted, Kansas is much better athletes than we're putting out on the floor and can cover a lot more ground. But I think it's possible if you set up putting Fisher in the middle and then some combination of Reinhardt and Hauser on your wings, Marquette can get longer and can challenge shots in the corner, and you got a rebound out of it. But I think it's absolutely a possibility. We could see some zone for the first time this season on Sunday.
So I want to throw it to each of you because I want to get everyone's thoughts on kind of what you're looking for from Marquette. We've had three positive games. We've had some time to mentally bounce back from the 2K Classic and hopefully a little bit more mojo heading into as we head down to Athens, Georgia. So for me, what I'm looking for, I'm looking to see if the extra time and focus on our pick and roll defense has made a difference against a quality opponent when we head down to Georgia. Almost more importantly, I want to see our senior leadership. There's going to be a point at the game against Georgia where they've taken the lead and the 6,000 people that are there are loud. There's going to be a point where we're losing the lead and things aren't going well. It's going to be like Pittsburgh. In that moment, I want a couple seniors to step up and not kind of revert back to their terror mode where they turn the ball over and it all goes to hell. I want to see progress from our seniors on staying composed in that moment, because it's going to come. And if you can't do it against Georgia, you're not going to do it against Xavier. You're not going to do it against Villanova. Pete Mohan, what are you looking for in this game from Marquette, kind of big picture?
I'm just looking forward to seeing how they respond to a player like Maiton. I'm not quite sure what other guys individually will be facing that might fit his style, but it's a position we've struggled to guard in the past, and it's critical moving forward. You know, you never know who you might face in the tournament, even to be able to guard a guy like that and to be able to shut him down. And I'm sure they'll have to try a few different strategies, but I'm looking for what Wojo thinks is the answer. And I wouldn't be surprised if he threw some helt at him just because he has the most heft.
Throw some helt at him.
Helt's heft could help.
That helter-skelter defense.
So, I don't know. It's all about defense. The offense will be there. I think that, well, we can get to predictions later, but I think that our shooting is what separates us in this one.
My biggest question coming in, Pete, you already kind of alluded to it. Will Luke Fisher guard Yante Maiton? I'm very curious to see if Wojo will do that. And when it comes to an expectation, Mike, I think this can be a decisive victory. I want to see Cheatham, Johnson, and Fisher be our best players. And I think they're capable of handling themselves and being our three best players against Georgia. The best thing they do is rebound the ball. We do a good job hitting the glass. I think we win going away.
Pete Wirth, expectations.
Yonte Maton, Georgia relies on him to do everything for him, for them. And I think if we're able to get the ball to Luke and he's able to get him into foul trouble, that'll be a huge thing. That'll be a huge advantage to us. And we've done a lot better at getting Luke the ball. And they've been against Houston Baptist, Dewey Pooey, and Western Carolina. But you can clearly tell that Wojo has made it a priority to get him the ball and get him the ball in better spots and better position near the hoop. And so if we can continue to do that against Maton, get him kind of in foul trouble, we always talk about Luke possibly getting into foul trouble, talk about the other guy for once. That would be a huge key. And I think Luke's play, not only on offense, but especially on defense when he is facing Maton on the other end, that's going to be the deciding factor in the game.
One more thing before I throw it out to you guys for final predictions. I wanted to touch on something that I've been thinking about a lot over the past few days, and I know Anonymous Eagle wrote an article on it, and that's...
Mrs. Henry's meatloaf.
Well, I'm always thinking about that. Caden Reinhart didn't play against Western Carolina. Apparently, he's been sick for the past couple of days and just simply couldn't play. We've all recognized the inefficiency that Caden Reinhart's been playing with, particularly shooting the ball. And I wanted to know, you know, Anonymous Eagle basically posted an article calling for Steve Wojciechowski to bench Caden Reinhart. In my opinion, I don't think that's the solution. I think you need to continue to coach the kid up, give him opportunities. I think his aggressiveness is a positive thing when it's harnessed. Now, you're not going to be able to totally eliminate all inefficiency from him, but I think, as we saw a couple games ago, particularly against Uwe Pooey getting to the hole, that changed what we look like. So if Caton can look like that or a version of that against Georgia, I think that's the version of Caton we need, not to mention his size on defense.
He's not going to shoot 27% from three all year. I mean, unless... At least I don't think he will. I mean, he's proven that he can do better than that at USC with the ball in his hands, probably even more than he does with this current Marquette team. But if he's going to shoot like that, we're in trouble unless the other guys are performing. And
no, we got replacements.
Yeah, but with a guy that his size, I mean, we definitely need him, you know, in the interior. And his ability to shoot the ball.
Well, I'm not advocating for him to be benched either. I think him and Hauser is a nice little rotation.
It's getting late here on the East Coast. Pete Wirth, I'm going to throw it to you first. Prediction for the game against Georgia, Marquette, or Georgia. Who you got?
We've talked a lot about these three cupcakes a little bit and how little they've meant. But I don't know. I think that they have really got us in a positive. They got us playing very well, especially on offense, and especially in getting the ball to Luke Fisher. And I think that Georgia struggles so much from the perimeter. I think we can allow Maton to get his, and if we're moving the ball like we have in the last few games, then I think we're hitting shots, we're making things happen in the paint, we're getting the ball to Luke. And I think we let Maton get his, let Frazier get his, but we prevent any of the other guys from hurting us. And I think we actually come out on top because I think we're more talented, and I think we get a 7-point win.
Pete Mohan.
Like we've all talked about, Maton's going to be a tough matchup. I think one of the keys, though, is how do we handle Frazier? The guy can shoot from the 3-point line, and so we need to be prepared to shut him down because we can't have them both going off against us. So can our perimeter depth chase him around for the whole game and tire him out, stop him? I think that we do. I think we just have more bodies. I think we end up winning this one by 8 in Athens. And I'm gonna make a further prediction. I think that we will win 2 out of the next 3 games.
Oh, bold. Brian Henry, final prediction.
If we win on the glass, I think we win this game going away, and not that close. If Georgia beats us up on the glass like they're very capable of doing with the guys, even though they're not massive, they aggressively attack the ball off the rim on both ends, I think it's a very tight game that we can lose. We hit every other storyline possible, but that'll be the biggest one that I'll watch. I'll say we do it. I'll put the rose-colored glasses on. I think this is potentially an 8-plus, 10-plus point victory on the road against a Georgia team, and it's a win they need going into Fresno and Wisconsin.
So a lot of bullishness on Marquette winning in Georgia from these three fellows. We got 3-0 so far. I'm going to go with a Marquette win as well, though I think it's going to be a lot closer. I need to see. I think we've got the shooters to run away with this game, but until we've proven that we can do that on the road in a potentially hostile environment and not against Vanderbilt, I need to see that first. So I think Marquette gets a three-point win, but it's going to be close, and there's going to be a moment in the second half, early in the second half, where I think we're going to have to mount a bit of a comeback, and I want to see what we're made of at that point.
A lot of diversity here on the show. We got a 3-point win, a 7-point win, an 8-point win, and Brian, what did you say?
I said I think it 8 to 10 plus.
I heard Eric say from Hong Kong that we'd lose by 18. So
don't let anybody tell you the Real Chili Podcast doesn't have enough diversity of opinions.
There you go, it balances us out. We're fair and balanced.
We're the Fox News of Marquette Podcast.
All right, folks, that's going to do it for us here tonight on the Real Chili Podcast. Hope you enjoyed the Georgia preview. We will be back on Sunday afternoon to recap the Georgia game and get ready for a very busy week and a very important week for the Marquette basketball program as they will face off against Fresno State and then the Wisconsin Badgers in Milwaukee.
And as we say goodnight, hop on that midnight train.
Thanks so much for listening. We'll talk to you next time here on the Real Chili Podcast.
Said he's going back,
going back
to a simpler place and time. Oh, yes, he is. Now be with him.
I know you will.
On that midnight train to Georgia.
Leaving on that midnight train.
I'd rather live in his world than live without him.
All right. Sports.
UVA won. Indiana's winning. Clemson beat Nebraska. It's big.
So long, Mark Paul Gosselaar, ye of Western Carolina.